Click the bell icon to get latest videos from Ekeeda.
Hello friends, I welcome you all to this video. We are with the 12th chapter of microwave engineering, where the various microwave passive component devices we have been addressing so far. We introduced to the family of microwave hybrid circuitries into the first topic, added the information with respect to the microwave waveguide junctions, and we have also seen the scattering matrix theory. Corresponding to the input and output reflected powers, we have the scattering matrix determined there for the N by N order. Next to that, we have also analyzed the operation for E plane T, H plane T. Onto the H plane T, we have solved two of the problems in the previous two videos also. Let us have the magic T details. So here we start with the topic, that it is magic T's. Magic T's is also called as hybrid T. It is also sometimes referred to as EH plane T. The name of magic T to be the EH plane T comes from, as it is the combination of E plane T and that of the H plane T, both of them. So let us first of all have the schematic diagram, how exactly the magic T look like, and then let us have the determination of the scattering matrix along with the knowledge to how the behavior of magic T is corresponding to the different ports is there. Now, as we know that the E plane T and H plane T are the waveguide junctions having the rectangular cross sections here. So very first of all, we consider the port number 1 having the opening as a rectangular cross section. Now it is running to the opposite side for port number 2. So let us have it in this particular direction. So we extend it to the middle portion where we have a junction. So this is the junction we have representing. And to this particular junction, we have the E arm obtained here. So it runs further up to the port number 2 here. So the port number 2 can be having the opening onto the another side like this here. And along with the E arm, it is also having the H arm possible here. So for the H arm, we have the connection like this. So this will be the opening for H arm, and it can be further connected to the port number 1 and port number 2 like this here. So this completes the schematic diagram for the magic T here. We provide the nomenclature to this particular schematic diagram. This is our port number 1, whereas this is port number 2 here. This is port number 3 and this is port number 4 here. So E plane T and H plane T were 3 port microwave junctions, whereas magic T, also called as hybrid T, is a 4 port waveguide junction here. So the port number 1 and port number 2 forms a pair of collinear ports. This is port number 1, this is port number 2 here. Port number 3 is called as E arm, whereas port number 4 is called as H arm. While we discuss the operation of the magic T, so if we have the two waves of equal magnitude and the same phase provided as input to port number 1 and that of the port number 2. So that time the output at port number 3 will be equal to 0. Whereas the output is additive at port number 4. So this is the property of H plane T. So both the inputs at port number 1 and 2 are added to find the additive or the summation output at port number 4, whereas port number 3 output is 0. This is the one kind of the behavior. In the another form, if we provide the input to port number 4 there, so that time it will not appear at port number 3. For port number 3, it will be again the output 0. The input will be splitted into the two parts corresponding to port number 1 and port number 2, which will be in phase here. So this is again the property of the H-plane T here. Next to that, if we provide this time the input to port number 3, so that time we have the input distributed into the port number 1 and port number 2, which will have the equal magnitudes at port number 1 and 2, but out of phase by 180 degrees. So for example, if we provide 20 milliwatts of power, 10 milliwatts in positive in this direction, minus 10 milliwatts in this direction, so this designates out of phase by 180 degrees by the change of sign here. Now, when we provide input to one of the collinear arm, so either we go for port number 1 or port number 2 also, it will not appear into the opposite collinear arm. It will produce a phase delayed output at port number 3, which is E arm, and H arm causes the phase advanced output. So this is how the behavior of the EH combination hybrid T, hence the name is called as magic T. Let us first of all derive the scattering matrix for the magic T. So as we know that the magic T is having the 4 ports, so therefore the order of the scattering matrix, it will be 4 by 4, 4 rows and 4 columns it should have. So the generalized representation for magic T scattering matrix can be given as the first row having S11, S12, S13, S14. Second row is having S21, S22, S23, S24. The third row is having the elements S31, S32, S33, S34. And the fourth row is having the elements S41, S42, S43 and S44 here. So let us say this is the representation of the scattering matrix for the magic T given by equation number 1 here. So as we know, the port number 4 is of the H arm here. So therefore, because of the H plane T section, we have the relationship for S23 to be equal to S13. So there it will be the input to port number 3 of the H plane T, if it is the case. So that time we provide the equal magnitude and the same phase outputs at port number 1 and 2. So let us say this is equation number 2. Now, because of the E plane T section, we know that for the input provided to that of the E arm, we create the equal amount of magnitude but out of phase by 180 degrees outputs at port number 1 and 2. Therefore, the corresponding scattering coefficients S24 is equal to minus S14. So this can be equation number 3 here. Now, as we know that port number 3 and port number 4 corresponds to that of the H plane T, H arm, and E plane T, E arm. So these ports 3 and 4 are a pair of isolated ports. Therefore, we can get the scattering matrix S34 is equal to S43. Both values are equal to 0. Let this can be equation number 4 here. So this can be because of the geometry of the junction as well. Now, using the equations 2, 3 and the 4, the recent one, equation number 1 implies the modification into the scattering matrix represented for the magic T here. So the first row we shall be having S11, S12, S13, S14. The second row, it will be S21, S22, S13, minus of S14 here. Whereas in the third row, we have S31, S32, S33, 0 at the fourth place here. S41, S42, 0 at the third place, and S44 at the last here. So this can be regarded as equation number 5 in the sequence here. Now in the third topic of the chapter, we have gone through the 5 properties of scattering matrix. So using the symmetric property, we know that S suffix ij is equal to S suffix ji here. So therefore, we can have the combinations for the scattering coefficients. S suffix 12, nothing but S suffix 21. S suffix 13 is equal to S suffix 31. S suffix 23 is equal to S suffix 32, which is nothing but S suffix 13. We can have S suffix 14 is equal to S suffix 41. S suffix 24 is equal to S suffix 42, which is equal to minus of S suffix 14 from equation number 3 here. And we can have S suffix 34 is equal to S suffix 43, which is to be equal to 0, as these are the pair of isolated ports here. So let us see, this is all is equation number 6 here. Now we know that the E plane T and H plane T arms inside the magic T are having the perfect matching with respect to the junction here. So therefore, there are no chances of reflections from port number 3 and port number 4. Therefore, we have S33 is equal to S44 is equal to 0 because of the perfect matching to the junction. Let us say this is equation number 7. Now, using the equations, six and equation number 7, equation number 5 here implies to the form of the scattering matrix S is equal to, the first row is S11, S12, S13, S14. Second row is S12, S22, S13, minus S14. Third row becomes S13, S13, 0, 0. Fourth row becomes S14, minus of S14, 0, 0 here. So this representation of the scattering matrix can be given by equation number 8 for the magic T here. And if we come to observe the scattering matrix coefficient here, earlier there it were 4 rows and 4 columns, the total 16 unknown scattering coefficient values. Whereas now it has been reduced to only 5 unknowns. So if we are successful to determine the 5 unknown values for S11, S12, S13, S14 and S22, we can have the substitution at all the 16 places to complete the scattering matrix for magic T. Now let us make the use of unitary property for scattering matrix. As per the unitary property, we have the scattering matrix when multiplied to its complex conjugate form. The multiplication is nothing but the identity matrix here. So let us have the representation of the scattering matrix. So very first matrix, it is S11, S12, S13, S14. In the second row, we have S12, S22, S13, minus S14. The third row is S13, S13, 0, 0. Fourth row is S14, minus of S14, 0 and 0. So this is the first matrix onto the left hand side. To its multiplication, we have the complex conjugate representation. First row is S11 conjugate, S12 conjugate, S13 conjugate, S14 conjugate. Second row is S12 conjugate, S22 conjugate, S13 conjugate, S14 in negation and in conjugate here. The third row involves S13 at two places, which is in complex conjugate representations. 0 will be the same. And the fourth row, it will be S14 conjugate minus of S14 conjugate, 0, 0 here. So this matrix multiplication will resultant into the right hand side having the 4 by 4 identity matrix. It will be 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1 here. So let this representation, because of the unitary property, is equation number 9. Now for the equation number 9, just now we have expressed, let us have the matrix multiplication operation, that it is R1, C1. So for the two matrices, we select the first row for the first matrix here and get the coefficients multiplied to the corresponding coefficients into the column first of the second matrix multiplicand here. So this results into the form of equation. We obtain mod of S11 squared added to mod of S12 squared added to mod of S13 squared, and the last term onto the left hand side will be mod of S14 squared, and this is equated to the first row first column element, that it is 1 from the identity matrix. So let this be the equation number 10 here. In the similar fashion, if you take R2 C2 operation, it will imply us to the equation of the form mod S12 square added to mod S22 square added to mod S13 square added to mod S14 square. This is equal to also 1. Next equation, equation 11 it is. For the third row and third column, if we have the similar operation, as two of the coefficients are 0, we obtain mod S13 square plus mod S13 square is equal to 1 here. So as both the terms are same, we can get it to the form to determine the value of S13 coefficient. It is equal to 1 upon square root 2 here. So simplifying it to the twice of mod S13 square, 2 can be shifted to the denominator of right hand side, and taking square root on both the sides will result in this particular value. So out of the 5 unknowns to be determined, 1 unknown is now available to us. This is equation number 12 we can represent. So up till now, as we have gone through matrix multiplication operations R1 C1, R2 C2, R3 C3, let us have R4 C4. So R4 C4 results into mod of S14 squared added with mod of S14 squared, again equated to 1. So therefore, twice of mod S14 squared is equal to 1. So it will give us the value of S14 scattering matrix coefficient is equal to 1 upon under root 2 here. So let us outline this value obtained. This is equal to equation number 13. Now let us have the comparison of equations 10 and that of the equation 11. To see both the equations, we come to see the two terms having the S11 and S22 should be same here. So S11 is nothing but S22. So these findings we can outline and get it represented by equation number 14 here. Now let us make the use of equations 12 and that of the equation 13. So that equation number 10 implies to the information of the form. We have S11 mod square added to S12 mod square plus 1 by 2 plus 1 by 2. This is equal to 1. So we have substituted to the values of the two places here, And finally, it can be further simplified to the form mod S11 square plus mod S12 square. So this is equal to, we have 0 here, because 1 by 2 plus 1 by 2, it will be 1. And when we get it shifted to the right hand side, 1 minus 1 will give us 0 here. Now, this equation is true only when we have S11 is equal to S12 is equal to 0. Otherwise, it won't be a valid equation here. So let us outline this conclusion here and give it equation number 15. Using the equations 12, 13 and that of the 15, we get the information from equation number 11. That implies we have 0 added to mod S22 square plus 1 by 2 plus 1 by 2. So this is equal to 1 here. So as we have only one unknown in this equation, S22 value is determined. And as we have the summation of these two terms to be equal to 1, so we finally obtain S22 is equal to 0 here. So the another unknown value is determined here, represented by equation number 16. So because of this finding, equation number 14 implies the equation S11 value to be equal to 0 here, because both were the same as determined into the equation number 14 here. So this is equation number 17 we can regard. Using the equations 12, 13, 15 and that of the equation number 16, we take the help of equation number 8 that will imply us to the final scattering matrix obtained by substituting all the 16 unknown values into the scattering matrix there. So we obtained the first row as 0, 0, 1 by root 2, 1 by under root 2 here. The second row is we obtain 0, 0, 1 upon under root 2, and last element is minus 1 upon under root 2. The third row is 1 by under root 2, 1 by under root 2, 0, 0. Whereas the last row is obtained as 1 upon under root 2, minus 1 upon under root 2, 0, 0 here. So this completes the scattering matrix for the E plane T, which is also called as magic T or the hybrid T here. So this is equation number 18 that is representing the final scattering matrix for magic T here. So now we have derived the scattering matrix for the magic T here. So with the help of the scattering matrix, we can establish the relationship for the incident powers and the reflected powers. So for that case, we can have the representation of the column matrix, the four elements to the first column, B1, B2, B3 and B4. So this is obtained by making the scattering matrix multiplied to another column matrix having the incident powers there. So scattering matrix we generate here, we have 0, 0, 1 by under root 2, 1 by under root 2, 0, 0, 1 upon under root 2, minus 1 upon under root 2 to the second row here. The third row is 1 by under root 2, 1 by under root 2, 0, 0, and the fourth row, 1 upon under root 2, minus 1 upon under root 2, 0, 0 here. So this is in multiplication to A1, A2, A3, A4, respective to the four rows and only one column for the matrix of incident wave powers here. So from this matrix relationship, we can extract the equations for B1 to B4. So B1 is obtained as 1 upon under root 2 times we have the summation of A3 and A4 here. So let us represent it by equation number 19. We have the B2 obtained by taking 1 upon under root 2 to A3 minus A4 here. This can be equation number 20. The next reflected power B3 at port number 3 can be regarded as 1 upon under root 2 times the addition of A1 plus A2, equation 21, and B4 can be given as 1 upon under root 2 A1 minus A2 here, equation number 22 here. Now we can be discussing the 5 different cases to look at these relationships of the input and the reflected powers here. So let us have the case number 1 here. We provide input to port number 3, hence we provide A3 to be non-zero value. Whereas we provide A1, A2 and A4 values to be equal to 0. So there it means there it is no input provided to the other ports 1, 2 and 4. So using these inputs, the equations for the B1 to B4 gives us B1 is equal to A3 by square root 2, whereas B2 is equal to A3 by square root 2, the same value here. We obtain B3 is equal to 0, B4 is equal to 0. So on providing non-zero output to the port number 3, it means H arm here, we obtain the equal and in phase outputs at port 1 and 2, whereas port 3 and port 4 are not having any kind of outputs. So this is the property of H plane T. After case number 1, we go for case number 2. So for case number 2, we take A4 value to be non-zero, whereas A1 is equal to A2 is equal to A3 is equal to 0 here. So on providing A4 value non-zero, we obtain B1 as A4 divided by square root 2, whereas B2 we obtain minus of A4 divided by square root 2 here. We obtain B3 is equal to 0 and B4 is equal to also 0. So when we provide input to the E arm at port number 4, we get equal magnitude but with sign change. It means it is out of phase by 180 degrees, corresponding to the port number 1 and port number 2. So this is the property of E plane T. Now after these two cases, we go for the next case. It is case number 3 here. So for case number 3, we now provide input to port number 1 here. So A1 is non-zero, whereas A2, A3 and A4 are equal to 0. So this results into the values of B1 and B2 to be equal to 0, whereas B3 is equal to A1 divided by square root 2 and B4 obtained as A1 divided by square root 2 here. So as we have already discussed that when we provide input to one of the collinear arms here, the opposite side collinear arm does not obtain any kind of the output power, whereas at port number 3 and 4 corresponding to the H arm and E arm, we obtain the outputs with the phase advance and the phase delays there. So we have the outputs at port number 3 and port number 4 here. So because of the last property, the name given to the device under consideration is the magic T. As practically we can take the magic T in our hand, if you are working into the microwave engineering laboratory, you can see throughout from port number 1 to port number 2, but on providing input to port number 1 or port number 2, it is not yet available at the opposite port, but it generates the output into the ports 3 and 4, hence the name magic T here. Now we shall focus our attention onto the next case, case number 4 here. So for case number 4, we take here A3 and A4 value to be of the same magnitude and the same phase, hence represented A3 is equal to A4 is equal to small a, whereas A1 is equal to A2 is equal to 0 here. So the same phase, equal magnitude inputs are provided to port 3 and 4. So this results into the value of B1, 1 upon under root 2 times twice A, whereas B3 is equal to B2 is equal to B4 is equal to 0. So this is the additive property. So as we have gone through the inputs to port number 1 and 2, so it will be added to port number 3 for H plane arm here. So same is the case if we provide inputs to the E arm and H arm here with the same magnitude and same phase, we get it added at port number 1. The last case here we can address, that it is case number 5 here. So for case number 5, we keep A1 is equal to A2 is equal to A, and A3 and A4 are equal to 0. So this gives from the equations for B1 to B4, we obtain B1 is equal to B2 is equal to B4 to be with 0 values, and B3 value is obtained as 1 upon under root 2 or twice A here. So this is the just property we have discussed of the H plane T here. So this is also the additive property. So after determination of the scattering matrix and discussing 5 properties with respect to the magic T, let us have the discussion with respect to the 3 selected applications here, because of which the magic T is very popular in the microwave engineering domain. The first application can be regarded as measurement of impedance here. So I can say this is impedance measurement. So for the impedance measurement, the arrangement with the help of the magic T can be of the schematic diagram I shall be drawing here. So as we know that there are 4 ports in the magic T here. So to the port number 1, we have the impedance denoted by capital Z1. This is the standard variable known impedance. Now it is connected to the magic T port number 1, whereas port number 2 onto the another hand will be connected with Z2, which is basically the unknown impedance, and this unknown impedance is to be calculated by the use of magic T. So port number 1 and port number 2 are done. To the port number 3, it is having the perpendicular orientation if you see the geometry. So we have been connected microwave source here. So we are providing certain kind of microwave signal as input to the port number 3 in this particular fashion. And at the port number 4, we have a connection to that of null detector. Now in this situation, when we provide input to the microwave source at port number 3, we get this represented as A3, the incident signal here, which is distributed at port number 1 and port number 2 as per the property of magic T. So it will be 1 upon square root 2 times A3. Here also 1 upon square root 2 times A3. Both will be of equal magnitude and the same phase here. Now as the Z1 and Z2 are the impedances that will not be directly or perfectly matched to the characteristic impedance Z0, they will produce the reflections. So the reflections come in this direction and will be fed as input to that of the null detector here. So the reflections here will be of the form 1 upon under root 2 A3 into rho 1. Whereas we have 1 upon under root 2 times A3 into rho 2, where rho 1 and rho 2 are the reflection coefficients corresponding to these two ports, port 1 and port 2. So now at null detector, we have the component from port number 1. So it is 1 upon under root 2 times 1 upon under root 2 times A3 into rho 1. Whereas here minus 1 upon under root 2 times, we have inside the bracket 1 upon under root 2 A3 into rho 2 here. So now because of this particular arrangement, it is just like a bridge here, and the bridge is to be balanced. So the net amount of power for the incident microwave signal that has been available at the null detector can be given as 1 upon under root 2, as just now we have shown onto the schematic diagram, 1 upon under root 2 A3 into rho 1 minus of 1 upon under root 2 1 upon under root 2 A3 into rho 2 here. So this is equal to 1 by 2 times A3 in the bracket rho 1 minus rho 2 here. Now the structure is like a bridge here, and by the perfect balancing of the bridge for the null detector condition, we have to equate it to the zero here. So this is to be equated to zero. So this will be the condition after balancing the bridge here. So here we shall provide rho 1 minus rho 2 is equal to 0, or rho 1 is equal to rho 2. So the reflection coefficient in terms of the impedances can be also determined here. So in terms of the impedances, finally we have to match the impedance Z2 to that of the impedance Z1. So one of the impedance is known and another impedance is unknown here. So therefore, by the use of magic T, finally we can have the impedance measurement of the unknown values here. Now the next application of the magic T is to work as duplexer here. So duplexer is nothing but the use of the antenna both for the transmission purpose as well as the reception purpose. By using the magic T, we can have the arrangement as port 1 connected to the microwave source here. So it will be having the transmitter section onto the opposite side for port number 2 here. Whereas for port number 3, we have the use of matched load here. And now for port number 4, we have the use of antenna. So this is at port number 4 here. So now as we know that the port 1 and port 2 are totally isolated pairs of the port, whereas port 3 and port 4 are also the pair of isolated ports here. While working as antenna for transmission purpose, we have the half power to be transmitted into the space and half power provided to the match load here. Whereas we have the antenna working as the receiver here. So the half power that will be received and that can be further splitted into the arrangement here. So we have the flow of power associated from the antennas working as both transmitting antenna and the receiving antenna can be shown like this here. So for the transmission section, we have the distribution in these two arms toward the port 4 and port 3 here. Whereas at reception, we have one source going to the microwave source and another going to the transmitter section. Hence, the use of magic T for the duplexer purpose is also possible here. Next to the application of magic T for the working of duplexer antenna here is the use into the mixer here. So magic T as mixer into the communication engineering block diagram system you might be remembering here. So as we have the arrangement of magic T like this, So let us have again for port number 4, the antenna. Now to work magic tea as a mixer here, we have the arrangement of local oscillator to port number 3 here. And we have the matched load at port number 2 here. Whereas this mixer block is having the intermediate frequency IF provided at port number 1 here. So while we work with this kind of arrangement having the magic T here, we can have the signal frequency denoted by F suffix IN, and it will be having the reception from the antenna like this, whereas the local oscillator will be providing the frequency F suffix 0. The two sections towards the mixer and the match load will be like this. So the IF frequency can be obtained as FIN minus F0. So that time the magic T with this arrangement can also be working as mixer here. So this was all about the magic T, which is also called as the hybrid junction or the EH plane T here. So it is a combination of the E plane T and H plane T. All the details we have reported so far. By the next lecture, we shall be having a simple problem to practice for onto the magic T, and we shall be continuing into the same chapter, microwave components. I hope you are definitely enjoying learning with the microwave engineering topics. For more such information and concepts to see, you can subscribe to Ekeeda channel.